Congratulations to you. There was a line in this film that really struck me, and it made me think about my own childhood. There's a line where Vicky's character basically says that, you know, don't let the kids see me cry. And there's this moment when I was growing up, I think I only saw my dad cry twice in my entire life. Once when our like dog died, and that was it. But there's something interesting about a father or a mother crying in front of their own children. And I wanted to ask kind of that about that line particularly, and why you think that's such an interesting thing for a vulnerability aspect for parents.
Wow, that's such a great line to bring up. I do think it's how much their relationship with their kids is shifting so fast. You know, they used to be babies, and now, you know, Thomason is her size and saying, hey, no, wait here, talk to me. And she's just like, I'm still acting like they're five, and you know what, they're not, they're adults. And it's a beautiful, beautiful thing of like, you know, trying to be, parents are supposed to be these rocks for us. And that's the illusion that we're on. It gives us safety. But in a kind of extreme situation like this, are you allowed to break down? Because that would traumatize the kids. Cause essentially you're saying the world is not safe. And you haven't had a chance to be safe to even build up a sense of yourself and have strength to do with it. So I'm going to shatter that if I'm falling apart in front of you. It's a really fascinating line that you brought up there, because it's about our roles and our responsibility in those roles.
I genuinely found this to be such an immersive experience to a point of being disoriented. And I'll tell you why. As we're looking at partial shots of people's faces, I found myself in my seat going like this, looking around the frame. And I obviously see the whole frame in front of me, but the way you actually finally reveal someone's age, or they reveal that they've aged, but first you give us a section of their face or a section of their head. I thought that was a brilliant way to do it. Can you talk about creating that level of immersion to a point where we kind of move around looking for it?
Well, that instinct that you're talking about is, I find, one of the most exciting aspects of making films is that it's a three-dimensional format in a frame, and we're insinuating everything else. So your brain is filling in everything else that's off the, and so using that to tell the story is amazing. It's you know, if someone's looking off and you never see the other person that's talking, that's amazing that you're filling it in just off of her expression as she's reacting, all of those choices. So if I'm just showing you a little bit, it's teasing, and it's, you know, provocative. It's both compositionally provocative, but storytelling wise, I'm making you lean and think. And what my favorite thing is, we showed this to an audience, and they all, the two things I love is that no one sits back. They're all like this, and no one goes to the bathroom. Everybody's just like, you know, for 2 hours, they're all like that. And that's this constant kind of, is that her voice? I wonder what. And you know, the other part of it is how to depict aging without it being kind of gimmicky. And I'm staring at so-and-so actor in prosthetics without it becoming that, which it pulls me out when I see that. No matter how well done it is, I'm seeing whoever it is. Winona Ryder in makeup, Robert De Niro in makeup. I'm always seeing, because what's really interesting about that is psychologically, we have an easier time accepting a new actor as a person later on than the same actor in makeup, because it feels like time froze there and they changed, just their look changed, but they're still that person. But when you use a different actor, we feel completely different. Like, you at 12 years old were a very different human being, you know? So it's fascinating psychological experiment on how to convey aging. And so I didn't want it to be a gimmick. I wanted it to be natural and use different forms of telling it. One of them was insinuation of the frame.
Two more quick questions for you. I'll throw these at you real quickly. Only because when the film ended, I went and Googled Jack Nicholson and Marlon Brando. And I'm like, I have never seen The Missouri Breaks. And I have to ask you what the significance of that was, because I now want to watch that film because of you, man.
Oh, well, here's, I'll get it. Tell you one thing. I've never seen it. So that's one. And two, it's my dad. It's from my dad, who actually has some dementia, and he would not stop talking about Jack Nicholson and Marlon Brando, this movie that they were in. And I was like, Dad, I've never seen it. And he just Jack Nicholson, Marlon Brando. And he kept going on and on and on. I was like, Dad, I'm putting this in a movie if you keep talking about this. And then he did. And it would, for me, it represents kind of like this thing that someone's holding on to for their sanity. Everyone must know. These are the two greatest actors of all time in a movie. Yeah. Why doesn't everybody know this? Why doesn't everybody know? You know, and so they can't understand it, but they're holding on to this, and it's a thing that doesn't make sense to them, and they're holding on to it. So it was just a kind of a funny, sad, beautiful thing about my dad and cinema. Oh, and wow. So I gave it, and I gave for all the crew members that finished the sound on the movie, I gave them all Missouri Breaks t-shirts, so they all have them.
Well, I'm going to be watching that right after this interview's over. I'll end on this. I want to say thank you for shooting on 35 millimeter. There's nothing looks better than 35. And there was this great moment, and this is maybe just me because I'm a fan of Unbreakable. In the beginning of Unbreakable on the train, when you're going back and forth in that one-er, you kind of have a similar one in this one when they get to the hotel for the first time as we go back and forth along the glass. Can you talk about shooting on 35 again and kind of, I know you've shot 35 a lot in your career, but what 35 means to you, and was that really an Unbreakable homage in that shot, or am I just kind of reading into it?
Dude, you and I could talk forever, dude. You and I mean, you know, we got to get a drink because this is like, we have lots to talk about, but I shot on film because I tested everything. And honestly, only film could capture the complexity of sand and water. It's because it's so naturalistic that and the chemical process of film is also naturalistic, but the digital, it's grabbing the wrong information, and it's showing, it's very cold when I look at it on digital, where the sand and the thing, that's the primary reason. And also Mike and I are very, you know, we're very old school and the things that interest us. And so we want that texture and grain. But that shot you're talking about, funnily enough, was inspired by Tarkovsky. So it was, so there's a, you know, he has a lot of these long back and forth. And I believe it was a movie I was watching. It might've been Sacrifice that of his. And it just, you know, back and forth hypnotically. It's part of the movement of time thesis of the camera that I was doing in the film. So that's what that bouncing was.